Thank you for your words, Damien. Indeed, this is my second topic in this wonderful meeting. And it's about femoral neck osteotomy in skeletally mature patients. So I have, these are my disclosures. As you know, for a long time that proximal femur intertrochanteric osteotomies have been used as realignment procedures. However, there are certain disadvantages. The fact that you shift lateral or medial the femoral diaphysis and you move around the center of rotation of the joint, you can have a major influence on limb length, as you can see here. Sorry, not this pointer, this one. So you can change really the length of the limb. You can have loss of abductor strength because of the high position of the trochanter in various osteotomies. And the fact that you are correcting the deformity, creating a secondary deformity. And it's described that you can have later on total hip replacement with more complications. And the fact that you have no access to intra-articular pathology unless you do a simultaneous surgical dislocation with an intertrochanteric osteotomy, which I think it's a quite demanding procedure. But if you shift a little bit more proximal the level of the osteotomy to the femoral neck, as you can see here, in this case, we are going to simulate a 20-degree varus osteotomy. By doing a medial close wedge or lateral open wedge, you have much less influence on those parameters that you have seen. On the same way, if you produce a valgus osteotomy, if you do this like producing a close wedge, medial resection osteotomy, you will have nearly no change on the center rotation of the hip. Now you can also combine it with ASTAR reorientation procedures. So we do both procedures at the same time. This is a case of a young female patient with a severe dysplastic hip. There's a lateral migration of the femoral head. She has a high riding fovea, which is diminishing quite dramatically the area of contact between the two articular surfaces. And as a consequence, you have a cyst, which is already an osteoarthritis cyst. So this is my planning for this surgery. Of course, we need an ASTAR reorientation, for sure. And if we want to unload the fovea, the area of the fovea, you will need to do an overcorrection. But this is something that we don't want to do. So we must balance the weight-bearing area over the femoral head. And maybe we need to do something on the femoral side, which is not going to be too much a deformation in this very young patient. And this is the final result after the osteotomy has healed. Now let's see if we're able to correct all the problems. Yes, we have centered the joint. We have put the fovea on a much lower position and you have increased dramatically the surface contact area. Of course, to do this, you need to know the anatomy of the vascular supply to the femoral head. This is the keystone of the procedure. Namely, the fact that the deep branch of the medial circumflex artery is exiting the posterior compartment of the hip, very close to the lesser trochanter, 1 centimeter above the lesser trochanter. It's going around the tendon of the obturator externals. And it's going to penetrate the capsule here, about 1 centimeter distal to the insertion of the conjoined tendon of the external rotators. Sometimes you need to remove all the posterior bone of the trochanter. Sometimes you don't need to remove all the bone. But you need to expose the femoral neck 360 degrees around. And this is the deep branch of the medial circumflex artery, which is protected by this retractor, and it's included in a soft tissue flap that you can develop with visual control. And if you think, okay, this is more dangerous than to perform an intertrochanteric osteotomy, look at this picture. This is the same cadaver picture. You see, this is the intertrochanteric cut exiting at the medial part of the proximal femur, and as you can see, it's going to hit directly the deep branch of the medial circumflex artery. And here you have no visual control because normally you have the quadratus femoris attached in this area. So this is my experience. We have, this is a retrospective study. We have 14 patients, 16 hip, with an average follow-up of 7 years, 3 to 13 years, 26-year-old. Average age, 13 females, so females more frequently in this series. We have 9 cases of coxa valga with high riding fovea, the ones that I have shown before, 4 cases of varus neck and high riding trochanter, 2 cases of femoral neck fracture sequel, 1 case of AVN, and 7 cases. In 7 cases, we had to do additional PAO to address dysplasia. This is one case where you can see the acceptable parameter is normal, but she has a very high riding fovea, which is diminishing, again, the contact area between the two surfaces. So this is an upside-down dysplasia. The problem is on the femoral side, not on the acetabular side. So we decided to do a correction. In this case, it was a close-wedge neck osteotomy, and this is the final result at follow-up of 11 years. This is a mistake, putting the trochanter too low. At this time, I was not aware of this problem. Now I'm doing it in a different way. Anyway, as you can see, the joint line is quite good and the patient is happy about the result. This is another case. There's a severe overlap of the fovea capitis with the weight-bearing area, and she has also an acetabular dysplasia. This is the MRI showing that you have at least half of the contact surfaces between the acetabulum and the head is done with the fovea and not with the articular cartilage surface. So we have planned to do corrections on both sides. This is the result after surgery, and this is the final result at 3 years. So the neck is in a good position. We have also corrected the dysplasia. This is another complex case. It similar like to the case Tanast presented yesterday. This is a young male patient who sustained a femoral shaft fracture and a femoral neck fracture with broken hardware. So we could not perform any kind of osteotomy using a plate because the shaft fracture was not healed. So the decision was to do a surgical dislocation, remove the hardware, and we decided to do a close-wedge valgus osteotomy with distalization of the trochanter. And this is the final result after surgery, and this is the follow-up at 6 years. The limb is a little bit shorter, maybe 1.5 to 2 centimeters, but the patient is happy because he was still able to keep his hip, and he wears a shoe compensation, but he's quite happy about this hip. This is another case. It's a young female with 18 years old. She had acute leukemia, and she had an AVN related to corticosteroid therapy. As you can see here, there's a collapse on the femoral head, and this is the image of the MRI, so it's a quite huge area of necrotic bone. And there's a partial collapse here at this point. The location is mainly anterior, and the carpal angle is 135 degrees. This was the position. We decided to do a surgical dislocation. This is the position of the necrotic area, being from here, from 12 to 3 o'clock, as you can see on the face clock, MRI. So we decided to do a femoral neck rotation, because if you do a posterior rotation, you would put necrotic area on the weight-bearing area, so we decided to a more risky osteotomy, which to do an anterior rotation of the femoral head. This will put some tension on the retinaculum flap, but with this surgery, you can control the amount of tension you put on the vessels, and you can control when the head stops bleeding. 25 degrees, it means 2 hours in the face clock, was enough to unload this area. And this is the result after surgery. This is the result after the osteotomies have healed. And this is the result at 5 years. She had no progression to osteoarthritis, and this is the control MRI. So there's some collapse here. It's not quite regular, but I think it's better than it was before. And the same parallel to the femoral neck cut, where you can see here, this was the amount of rotation that we achieved. There's still some collapse here, but I think it did not interfere with the loading in this hip, so I think it's at least a fair result. This is our results. So we're able to normalize the neck shaft angle parameters. The fovea was in a much better position. Also, the acetabular parameters indicate that the PAO. And we assessed the patients using the non-arthritic hip score before and after surgery. There was a dramatic increase in the function of the hip. And we applied also the hip outcome score and the modified head hip score after surgery with at least having some acceptable results in terms of function of those hips. All the osteotomies have healed in 3 months. We had no cases of AVN observed. We had one case of greater trochanter non-union that motivated further surgery. One of the hips, it was, I think, one of the most, with the most long follow-up, it had progressed to osteoarthritis, but so far no conversion to total hip replacement. So the main limitation of this study is the fact that you have a very small number of patients with many different morphologies and indications. But we think this is a procedure that can be considered to be safe because we have experience from the pediatric patients in modified done osteotomies. It can be used in post-traumatic deformities. When you're doing this lateral approach, it will allow you to fine-tune the position of the trochanter and the abductor length, and you can combine with PAO to optimize congruency. This is a tip. This is the camera filming, and the surgeon was me. I was looking somewhere else, and this retractor was being held by one of the assistants. See? This is the retinaculum, and this is the anterior body of the glute. You saw. Be careful, because one movement, a non-intended movement, you can just strip away the retinaculum vessels from the head, and then you got AVN. So this is very dangerous. Please, this kind of surgery you can have no distractions. Another tip, when you fix the trochanter, you must fix first the distal screw, because if you fix first with the more proximal screw, this can happen. You can compress the vessels, especially when they are the reductant, and you can just kill the circulation for the head. If you do this first put your distal screw, then you are actively protecting the circulation for the femoral head. And normally I put in this location, more distally. So as take-home message, I think this is a feasible technique. Of course, it's demanding. The power of correction is huge. It can be safely used in selected adult patients. And of course, because it has more correction power, it can have some advantages over the classic trochanteric osteotomies. Thank you very much for your attention.